Each year, Microsoft Research hosts hundreds of influential speakers from around the world, including leading scientists, renowned experts in technology, book authors, and leading academics, and makes videos of these lectures freely available.
Hi, I'm Shabnam Irfani. I'm Director of Technical and Business Operations at Microsoft Research, and I'm excited to host Jake Kendall today from Gates Foundation. Jake is the Deputy Director of the Financial Services for the Poor team. He runs the R&D and he's here to tell us about the challenges that they're facing in that space. This is a particularly interesting space for Microsoft in terms of looking at the next 4 billion people who in future will be onboarded to not only our financial systems, but also software industry devices and so on and so forth. So without further ado, I'm going to hand it off to Jake and let him tell you about what he's working on.
Thanks a lot. Thanks. So thanks, everybody, for having me out and coming out to hear what we're working on. I think for me, the goal of coming out here is really, you know, I'll explain more about our team's work and our strategy, but we're looking to you know, our core vision for our strategy is to create the next generation of financial services models that are relevant for the 2 billion or so people who currently don't have any access to financial services. And a lot of that is not a technology problem, right? A lot of that is a regulatory issue or a business model issue or something like that. But a lot of it is a technology problem. And so, you know, we come out to see groups like Microsoft Research who have some of the top thinkers in technology and hope to both get feedback on how we're looking at the problems, but also, of course, potential solutions. So really, really excited to be here and talk to you guys. I'm Jake Kendall. Thanks for the introduction. I run the research and emerging tech team on the FSP, as we call ourselves, Financial Services for the Poor group within the foundation. Just a little bit of background on myself. I started in physics at MIT as an undergrad. Did a couple of years in rural Zambia as a Peace Corps volunteer. So that's where my real development training started, I guess. Spent some time then trying to apply what I'd learned at MIT doing cryptography with a couple of startups. But this was right around 2001 and was not a very good time to be doing startups. So ended up going back to get a PhD in economics, kind of bouncing back to the development world again. And spent a short time at the World Bank and then was picked up by the Gates folks. And started there as a PO, and I've been there 6 years, and now I'm directing one of the four initiatives on our team. So, just to give you some background on FSP, as I said, our kind of core mission is that group of 2 billion or so people who are currently outside the financial system, and then there's probably another billion who are very, you know, poorly served by whatever their current financial products are, to 1 or 2 more billion. So there's a large chunk of the world that just don't have any financial services, and so we're really working on how do we solve that problem. Our team within the foundation is what I would say medium sized. We're within the global development group, and we're about 115 million a year in grants and contracts. And we also do things like equity investments, debt investments, all those kinds of other tools, all with socially motivated purpose or a charitable purpose. Our team's about 28 people now, I think, changing every other week, I think. So, but bounces around 30. And as I said, we're broken into four different groups. Three of them are sort of oriented around geographies and the themes common in those geographies. And then my group is sort of a cross-cutting group. So the first group is really focused on, and I think the themes of the groups kind of show the breadth of the tools and the sort of many different angles through which we approach the problem. So the first group is focused on government policy, regulation, and sort of donor policy. So, you know, we run pretty significant advocacy campaigns within a lot of the countries where we work to advocate around particular regulatory changes, some of them fairly technical, but a lot of them having to do with regulations that either block competition at the low end of the market by putting it all in the hands of banks and certain types of financial players who are just not very motivated to serve people at the low end of the income spectrum, or regulations that just make it hard to serve people at low cost, which is of course imperative for people who are very poor. And so those are things like, you know, to what degree do you need to see identity, proof of identity, right? Do you need to see a proof of address? You know, better part of half the world doesn't have proof of address, right? So that those kinds of regulations rule people out unnecessarily, right? Because the people at that level of income are not really adding risk to the system in any significant way. And so if you can find creative regulatory structures that actually allow them to get accounts and to get onto the financial system without adding risk of, you know, terrorism finance and some of the other things that the regulators are very risk averse about. We also, in that same initiative, work a lot with government payments and try to get the government to think of itself as a sustainer of the system and a stakeholder in the digital payments and financial system. So if they're doing lots of transfers to citizens for welfare programs, famine relief, you know, maybe they're supporting students in school, whatever it is. Those payments are often done in a paper form or through a voucher or whatever it is. You know, massively corrupt usually and very inefficient. And if you transition those things to digital forms, direct deposit into mobile money accounts or bank accounts, and we'll get into a little bit of how some of that work. You know. Big efficiencies for the government, but also sustaining for the system itself, because that pumps volume and sustains the business model of serving those people at the lower end of the spectrum. Second initiative is focused on infrastructure, and the sort of core element of it is what we call the Level 1 project, which I'll go into, which is our design and reference model for a payment system that serves the poor. Focused in primarily Pakistan and Nigeria right now, where you know, we have good buy-in from the government to try and build out these systems at the national level. We then have a third initiative focused more in East Africa and Bangladesh, where the mobile money systems, and I'll go into a little bit, for those of you who don't know much about mobile money, what those are, but mobile money systems in those markets are more advanced. You have adoption rates of maybe 70-75%, for example, of the adult population in Kenya. Of mobile money products. And so, you know, you're clearly getting down to pretty low levels of income within that group, and you're also getting pretty much ubiquitous adoption of a digital payment and financial services product, which, you know, for us is quite a big win. But, you know, there's a lot more to do in some of those systems. And so we have a team that works on both sort of ecosystem development and on sort of next generation business models and that sort of thing. And then my group, which works on both client-side research to understand the impacts and the needs of low-income consumers and households and that sort of thing. So almost, you know, some of it's in the academic realm and some of it's more kind of data collection and surveys to collect the market intelligence. And then the upstream or emerging technologies. So, you know, looking at the emerging technologies globally in the financial sector, but also in other sectors, and how can we, you know, opportunistically capture the value that they can create in our sector and help those technologies transition into the market. So that's the broad overview of our team. I'll go into a little bit kind of our broader theory of change, and I'm getting to the more technology problems focused part, but I kind of want to give you all a broader sense of what our team does and why. And some of this is because I went out to your MSR Bangalore and dove right into the technology stuff, and they were sort of like, well, we don't actually know what mobile money is, or a lot of them didn't and stuff, so I wanted to give a bit more background here. So if you start, this is our team's broader theory of change, and if you start out there on the right side of that column labeled impact, you know, that's the goal that we're going for, right? What's the impact that we want to have in the lives of low-income population and poor households? And we start with the observation, you know, that a lot of the reason why people are poor is not that they're sort of born poor and stuck in poverty forever, but often they transition out of poverty. And in large numbers, we actually looked at the data globally, and you see, you know, anywhere from 15-30% of people who are at below $2 a day, which is kind of the nominal figure we use, transition out of that over the course of a couple years. But the problem is, of course, that a similar number transition back in. And that's because low-income people live a very a life of high uncertainty. They face a lot of shocks, in particular health-related shocks, which can, you know, cause loss of income, loss of job, of course, the expenditure around trying to cure an illness or a broken leg or whatever it is. And people end up, you know, in responding to these shocks, and shocks can also come in the form of, you know, a bad agricultural season for people who have rain-fed agriculture and that kind of thing. In the course of responding to these shocks, people are often pushed much further into poverty. And then you do see, of course, people moving out of poverty by getting a formal job or improving their entrepreneurial capacity. But that often also, this is why we focus on sort of the cycle of poverty. Both of those margins are affected by the ability to generate resources and to use financial services, right? So if you face a shock, the ability to borrow, the ability to have insurance or to reach out to family and friends or get a transfer from the government, all of those are kind of core coping mechanisms. And then the ability to capture an opportunity to get out of poverty often also requires some form of finance. So that's a kind of the core motivation. If you go one step in to the left, we think that in order to effectively bring financial services to the large number of people who currently don't have them, you have to move people onto digital platforms. There's been a longer history, of course, of microcredit, which many of you probably have heard of, and other banking, low-income banking and things like that, that have approached it from a much more analog process-based approach. And they've had some success. Microcredit, you know, had a certain amount of success, reached a couple hundred million people, but stalled out, and we think it's largely because that model just isn't sort of scalable and sustainable and has fundamental limits in terms of how low cost it can get and things like that. So we believe that it has to all be done over digital platforms in order for the cost curves and for the business model to work out in such a way that you can reach, you know, sort of the last mile of customer. And so then these five larger inputs to that are kind of the five areas. And since I covered what the team's doing, that kind of covers, but those are kind of the areas in where we think if we push on some of these levers, we can start to see some of this happen. So I wanted to give you next a bit of a background in mobile money, which is what I would say is sort of the current state of play, right? This is, mobile money is, financial services, primarily person-to-person payments that are delivered over mobile systems. And these are primarily low-end phones, which is the type of phone that people in developing countries, of course, tend to have at low levels of income anyway. And currently, they're kind of the one success story to date. I'll give you a sense of how broadly they are. We think there's fundamental issues with them, but they have demonstrated a fair amount of success. So I wanted to give you kind of a background in what they look like, and then we can think about what's the next step to kind of move beyond them. So a typical mobile money system starts with the MNO, which is the mobile network operator up in the left-hand corner. They'll partner with a partner bank, and they will, in order to create the digital value that's going to sit on their mobile money system, they'll usually put a deposit into the bank that will be backed, essentially, so that the value on the system is backed one-to-one with deposits in the bank. And so the bank, largely, that's the role that the bank plays. They hold that trust account and make sure that the MNO has backing of one-to-one. And then as part of that as well, they'll often open up to agents who can then also go in and buy digital value themselves on the account of the mobile operator. And agents are the small retail shops where the person who's going to come in and get their mobile phone signed up and then do transactions, that's where they go in order to get cash out, put cash into the system. So if the mobile money mobile operator will sign up a network of agents, and agents can, I'll give you some photos of what agents can look like. They're kind of any kind of retail shop in a developing country, and you see them in the smallest kind of informal market stall all the way to supermarkets and things like that. So an agent just signs up. They have a special type of phone. It's not necessarily a special device, but their account is special, and it allows them to do transactions with clients who they also sign up. So they'll sign up subscribers. subscriber will get a phone, get the phone registered with the mobile operator, and then they'll go at the agent, and then they'll, you know, the first thing that they want to do is load value onto the phone, right? So they'll give cash to the agent. The agent will accept the cash and basically transfer them value, electronic value, onto their phone in real time. So it's a one-to-one transaction. There's no credit, for example. They don't give the cash and then it appears later on their phone. It's real time, and it's one of the nice things about the mobile money system is that there's no, I don't need to trust the agent, basically. I know that he gave me the value. I can walk away. The agent eventually will accumulate enough cash. He'll go and put it in the bank, and that's how he buys more value. So it's almost like they're e-value merchants, right? They're just selling value. And sometimes they're buying value back, right? So if I actually want to pull money out of my phone because somebody sent me some money, I go in, I give cash, and I get the opposite, I get cash, and I transfer him value. So that's really the basics of how it works. And the core subscribers can then send money to other subscribers who may live a long ways away, and so they'll go to a different agent and pull money out there, and it's all sort of mediated on the back end. So that's roughly how mobile money works. I'm actually going to go to this slide first, and then we'll get back to the previous one. So this is just to give you a little bit of color in terms of what do these things look like in different places in the world. And this one up on top, this is a rural area in Bangladesh where the Bcash service is active. And you can see, you know, that's just a little tiny stall on the side of the road, right? But, you know, they're set up, they have the signage up, they have pricing up, and they, you know, that guy has a phone that he can give cash out or put cash in, or he can also help, you know, for people who don't quite understand the service and that kind of thing usually. Similarly, Kenya, I think that's one of the slum areas, so peri-urban, you know, pretty basic structure. Over here is actually, also in Kenya, is, you know, a pretty modern-looking supermarket chain where you can go in and pay with a credit card or do whatever you want. You can also pay with mobile money, right? You can buy your groceries. You can put cash in or take cash out. You know, all the functions that you can do at one of these more rural things, you can also do in these more advanced things. And it's kind of an elegant system in that sense, in that it, you know, it's very easy with a phone. You can pretty much install an agent anywhere. And if you think about comparing this to a bank branch, right? You know, the capex for building one of these is many orders of magnitude less than a bank branch. And in fact, the way that these things are franchised, the owner of the agent is the one who builds the structure. So for the MNO, the setup cost of rolling out an agent network of, you know, thousands and thousands of agents is orders of magnitude lower than a bank branch network, right?
Agent right. expect to earn on
yeah.
a dollar.
Great question. So, and I should know this, but they changed not so long ago. I think that they get about 15 cents, somewhere between 10 and 15 cents per transaction. Yeah. Might be closer to 20 at this point. But it's somewhere in that range. And so it depends a little bit on the volume. So if, you know, that's for a typical transaction, and then it scales up and down based on how much they're doing. And they get for both cash in and cash out, although the client basically pays only for cash out. So, you know, this is a decent way for, if they can do 10, 15 transactions a day, they can add 15, you know, sorry, $1.50, or sorry, about $3, something like that. And a good agent, we sort of estimate that for an agent to be truly viable, they need be doing about 50 a day. Otherwise, it's not that interesting as a proposition. So you know, when they get up into the maybe $10 a day range, that's when it starts to be more viable. And some of them are doing actually pretty well. They make, you know, $1,000 or $2,000 a month. They can actually crank out quite a bit. And some of it depends, of course, on the volume.
How does the sellers manage the payouts from a cash flow? I mean, it's not always a balance of payments that anyone
exactly.
installs.
Yeah. Yeah, it's a great question, too. And that's actually one of the pain points I was going to go into. Man, these agent networks tend to be about 50 to 70% of the kind of cost structure of a mobile money operation. A lot of the rest of it is marketing. The back-end systems actually, once you've built them, they don't cost very much to run. And there's not a lot else to it. And so these things, while they are, you know, course, dramatically cheaper than banks and ATMs and things like that. They still do, you know, both between the commission structure and there's a you know decent amount of kind of managing them, training them, recruiting them, all that kind of stuff that's kind of ongoing. Sorry, repeat your question.
To me, it was the payouts. So.
Yeah. Oh, how do they manage? So that and that's a big aspect of it for the actual, you know, the guy who owns this little place himself. He's got to figure that out. And in most cases, they kind of put that onto the local entrepreneur who's running these things. And you know, generally that's smart, right? Make the person who's best able to solve the problem. They'll find ways to either pay friends and relatives to go to the bank and come back, or actually go themselves at really slow periods during the day.
They have enough load to kind of cover in between.
Right.
But they might do it a day to get back down to the bank to replenish.
That's right.
And they have to kind of get to know their business there. Because I imagine some could be more on the payout side, some could be balanced, some could be more receiving.
That's right. Yeah. Yeah, it depends a lot. So rural areas tend to be all payout. People receive transfers from relatives in the city is sort of the standard thing, and then they come in and they, so it's all payout, and then they're running back and forth to the bank to get more cash. And cities can be more balanced, certain parts of cities. So
you had said that this starts with a mobile network operator. Is that always the case, or do other entities also start?
Good point. Yeah, so that's a typical, but it's not always the case. Actually, Bcash here in Bangladesh is not a mobile network operator. They have a very close partnership with mobile network operators, but they are actually one of the few third-party systems. In some countries, Pakistan, for example, regulations stipulate that there has to be a bank who's actually holding the funds, whereas in the model that I showed you, it was more a bank that was holding a trust account on behalf of the MNO. And so in those markets, what's happened is essentially the telcos have bought banks and essentially have them as sort of sub-lines of business. So technically it's a bank, but on some level it's also a mobile operator.
And in any one country, is it just winner takes all? Like there's one dominant system, or are there multiple systems, and are there brokers or exchanges between them?
Yeah, I'll get to that in a second, actually. I'll give you the sort of global landscape of what it looks like in terms of the market structure. Just real quickly, I'll run through this then. This is probably fairly obvious at this point, but you know, here's some of the common products or common things you can do with the mobile. With a mobile wallet, you can do cash in and cash out, of course. Airtime top up, so I can buy more airtime for my phone. Of course, as you guys probably know, most of the phones in developing countries are prepaid plans, so I buy minutes and then I use them. P2P or person-to-person money transfer, that's sort of the main use case. Bill payments are growing, so you pay your utility bills, your school fees, your cable bill, whatever it is. Merchant payments in-store. Everyone's always kind of believed that there's this big promise for in-store merchant payments, but it's been really hard and has not taken off. So that's a very small sliver of current transaction volume. Bulk payments, so one to many. And now more and more we're starting to see stuff here like down in the bottom three where banks are leveraging these platforms essentially so that they don't have to build these branches everywhere and so that they can reach people through their phone, through these agent networks. But allow them to use their more advanced banking products through that platform. Digital credit, where they're using kind of the transaction data flow around the product to do automated lending. And then there's a few groups that have experimented with freemium life insurance, where essentially they use it as a promotion and then try to get people to buy up. But you had a question?
So is person-to-person transfer kind of the main incent mechanism that gets people who are previously doing cash, you know, onto this?
Yeah. So I'll jump around a little bit just to answer the questions in real time. So this is the global product mix. It's data collected by the GSMA. That's the kind of global mobile operator or industry association. And we actually support a group within the GSMA who tracks mobile money and tries to act as kind of a thought leader or think tank for the field around using mobile money for serving low-income populations. You can see here on the volume side, most of the transactions are airtime top-up. And, of course, mobile operators love that, right? Cuts out the agent commission that they pay on all the guys who are selling the minutes because they don't have to pay anybody a commission on that. And is convenient for clients because, you know, you can buy airtime at any time from your phone. You know, good decent volume of it is That gray is P2P, and then there's a bunch of smaller stuff that's pretty low, some bill pay. And then the value, of course, P2P transfers are much larger. I mean, no one buys 50, rarely do you buy 50 or 100 bucks worth of airtime. But of course, when you do transfers to your family, and a lot of it is, you know, a lot of it traditionally has been, I'm in working somewhere and I want to send money back to my family. But actually now you see all kinds of things. You see a lot of small business owners, informal business owners who are, you know, using it to buy things from distant suppliers or manage their money in some way, even pay their employees. A lot of people support their family in other contexts, like kids going to school and all that kind of stuff. And so more and more you see kind of people doing all kinds of other use cases for it. But one of the driving use cases was essentially the sort of family income transfer thing. And yeah, it's almost always long distance, but more and more you also see with the especially with the small business merchants and stuff, they're starting to do it face to face.
And so if you go back 10, 15 years ago, I mean, what would people be doing instead of this to do those
yeah. transfers? So in a lot of cases, they were actually sending physical cash. You know, there were studies in Kenya, which is probably the most advanced market now, as I mentioned, pre-M-Pesa, and people would put they'd go find a bus driver who's going in the direction that they wanted to send money and say, hey, here's an envelope, please give it to so-and-so. And then they have to call that other person and say, hey, meet the bus driver, because, you know, if you don't, then he's probably going to take it. Or you know, they would happen to have a friend who's going in that direction, or they would just wait until the person came home Christmas or whatever it is. And so there was a lot of informal mechanisms that were very inefficient, fairly risky, hard to depend on, that kind of thing. And we've done sort of pretty rigorous academic studies looking at when mobile money rolled out, and comparing people who, just by the chance of where they lived and where mobile money rolled out first, had access to mobile money versus those who didn't, and suffered some sort of medical shock or some sort of other, you know, significant shock to their income or whatever, where they needed some money to deal with it. And you can see a big difference in the coping patterns and, in fact, the welfare outcomes of the people who actually had the mobile money, because they were able to get money from further away, from a broader group of people and larger amount and faster than the people who had to rely on sort of the regular cash transfers and things like that. So, you know, it really does affect even just that. And we actually see, I'm going to get to, you know, there are issues with mobile money. It's not open. You know, as you saw in that sort of diagram, if you think about the standard credit four corner model, where, you know, banks can join and merchants can join and that kind of thing, it's not an open system like that, and it doesn't allow kind of the flexibility to create new products and new offerings. It's pretty limited, but nevertheless, you know, it does improve people's lives. We think of the digital stuff as actually, you know, has that value of being faster and all that kind of stuff, but it's also really just a platform that you can build so many other things on. That's the real value of it. So,
how ubiquitous is mobile money in these markets? So, for example, is it predominantly with the lower incomes, or is it predominantly with the higher incomes, or pretty?
Yeah. Well, so it in terms of where it falls in the income spectrum, it tends to. I mean, our data shows that it tends to start with the sort of upper middle income, often, you know, people who are traveling a lot or just, you know, kind of new, more kind of willing to try out something new, probably have less to lose on some level. And so it kind of starts in that middle income band and may spread in both directions, but eventually does go kind of down market. We've sort of tracked it in Kenya since the early days and definitely seen, like, you know, it wasn't very high uptake in the sort of lower quintiles of income until more recently, but as it saturated, people did start to take it up. And some of that's driven just by mobile phone adoption. So in Kenya, it's kind of getting close to bumping up against overall mobile phone adoption in general.
Does cost structure modulate as more adoption goes in? So, for example, are there services for the lower income that can entice more to join in, or is it pretty standard throughout?
Yeah, they. So a lot of it is already geared to be a pretty universal need, the ability to move money over distance. I mean, it's pretty fundamental, right? And so the low-income populations, you know, why they didn't adopt right away, I think a lot of it was just not being in kind of the bigger cities and not having probably been exposed to it very much. But also I think, you know, there's a pretty strong network effect. And so for people that had a really clear need, like they're a small business owner who's going back and forth between two towns a lot and just wants to move money, like, you know, there's clear willingness to pay and that kind of thing. Whereas I think over time, you know, the network effects probably started to drive it more with the low-income populations. But there hasn't been a lot of really interesting low-income population only oriented products. I think,
lastly, the previous slide, there was also international remittances.
Yeah.
How does that work?
Well, so in while international remittances get a lot of press, I would say, in the especially in the development world, international development world, they're actually mostly for people who are better off. I mean, you really can't afford to send someone to another country, certainly not Europe or the United States, unless you're actually better off. And they're actually a pretty small percentage of the population in Africa and South Asia where we work. Certain countries accepted, right? So certain parts of certain countries in particular, there's, you know, a lot of cross-border traffic. But the basic way that they work is, you know, for M-Pesa, for example, they will open up a partnership with either certain banks, international banks that offer international remittance services, or I think with MoneyGram, for example, they have like a partnership. So they do some sort of back-end integration, and then someone sends you a remittance, and it gets put into your mobile money account, basically. So it's pretty similar to how, I mean, from a client perspective, it works pretty similar to how you just do it normally, except the sender would go to, you know, a money transfer outlet in a developed country or wherever they are.
So I imagine in most of these countries, majority of population is locked out of the traditional banking systems.
That's right.
What is the adoption rate for mobile money? And then the percentage that are not onboarded to mobile money, what do those guys, is it still a cash economy?
And actually, even for the folks who are adopting mobile money, they're usually adopting it around a couple of specific use cases. They want to move money, you know, twice a month from here to there, from their, you know, husband to wife or who's ever transferring, someone's working in a particular area. So the overall adoption rates vary a lot by country, and a lot of that has to do with regulatory, how recently regulations have opened up. Most countries in Africa and South Asia have some form of enabling regulation. Some of them are still kind of stuck, and the regulation is basically blocking it. But, you know, in East Africa, where it's most developed, the adoption rates are anywhere from about 70, 75 with Kenya, down to, I think, 30, mid-30s in Uganda. And then in other countries, it gets lower than that. And in India, for example, it's maybe 1, 2%. So it's, you know, almost nothing, basically. So it really depends on the level of market adoption. And it's really a network effect sort of a product. So, you know, if I'm the only one who has it, it's totally useless, right? It's like a phone. I mean, the more people that have them, the more useful they are. And so you do sort of see often kind of these countries will sit in the doldrums for a while where they just, you know, the operators are kind of investing and trying to get over the hump, and then eventually they'll kind of get a takeoff. And so East Africa has had that. A few other countries in Africa have had that. This data, by the way, is also from the GSMA. You can see sort of the global landscape of where things are. Some countries have 1, 2, and now more and more. This map would have looked a lot more sparse 3 or 4 years ago. Now most of them have more than one offering, which is good because you do see the price drop a fair amount. And you can see here, regionally anyway, sort of the total subscriber base. 21 services now have more than 1 million active users, and that, you know, we see 1 million as a pretty good threshold for where things are really taking off and they're getting good traction and that kind of thing. So that's been encouraging. That number has moved, probably doubled since, you know, 2 or 3 years ago. So and then 5 services have more than 5 million, and that again, you know, 5 million is a pretty active mobile money deployment at that point. But what you'll also see is, I think if you look at these circles, the dark center circle is the active user base, and the clear circle, the area proportional, is the registered user base, and you can see that there's large numbers of registered but inactive users, and that's a big problem that the industry faces. People will sign up, and then either they don't find the product compelling enough, or they forget their PIN, or they don't remember how to use it, or what have you. And that drives a fair amount of cost in the system, and is, again, one of the issues that we want to solve.
Apple Pay can speak to that.
What's that?
Apple Pay can speak to that.
In the sense that they have a lot of inactive users. Yeah, fair enough. maybe for different reasons, but. So I mentioned a couple times that, you know, we see mobile money as this kind of great demonstration case on some level and potentially a platform, but there, it has a lot of issues. And part of it is that, you know, we see this wheel is supposed to represent, like, you know, what we think is possible in the longer run using a better digital platform and a better set of technologies and business models. And you know, the ability to kind of capture and support all of these different payment use cases, right? People getting their salary, people paying suppliers if they're a small-scale farmer or entrepreneur, tax collection, you know, pension and other social transfers from the government, all the different payments use cases, and then, of course, all the financial use cases on top of them that have payments as kind of integrated into the system, right? So if you're doing credit, you want the data that's coming off of these systems, but you also want the ability to put into someone's wallet immediately the loan and not have to have them visited by a loan officer and that kind of thing. And that, you know, that's a huge difference in the cost structure if you can do it over a digital platform. So, you know, e-commerce, eventually, physical retail, all this kind of stuff. And we think that in the long run, you know, if you want to cut out the high cost things in the system, the high cost things are cash and physical person-to-person interactions, right, which tend to go together. And so what you want is that the value starts to circulate in digital form and stays in digital form, right? So right now, I send you money, you take it out and go buy stuff. You know, we're not really getting very far. It's better than putting money on a bus, but, you know, you're not really kind of creating a financial system where the sort of per transaction cost is you know, minuscule and infinitesimally small. Amortized over, you know, the whole system. So, and you still have to have all those physical access points and people and stuff involved. So we, you know, if we think about, can we make people long cash in the sense that, or long digital value, so we pay them in digital value, pay for their crops in digital value, get their money from the government in digital value, all that kind of stuff, that gives them an incentive to spend it in digital value. But then you also have to give them the capability to do commerce, day-to-day merchants, all that kind of stuff. And the world is very far, you know, the mobile money world is very far from being able to kind of actualize on that vision. So so now, a little bit getting into what our team's trying to do. So that's the background. And we were involved quite a bit globally in the scale-up of mobile money systems. We gave, you know, exploratory grants and to some of the early movers and that kind of thing. And have, you know, like I said, supported the industry because we've seen it as a valuable thing. But we also think, you know, and we think it's part of our role, is that the industry itself, you know, there's a next step to take, really, right? There's much further that they can go in terms of creating an open, scalable, more robust platform. So I'm going to show you sort of two areas, right? One is the platform work that we're doing, that our team's doing. And as I said, we've designed kind of a reference model for what we think the payment system needs to look like at that lower levels of income or to support those types of transactions. And that was a long and pretty in-depth process of studying kind of the current systems and what their shortcomings are. And then I'll give you kind of a next generation set of technology pain points or pain points that we think technology, you know, could readily solve. So just jumping into the platform stuff, you know, I was telling you the mobile money systems tend to be pretty bespoke, built for purpose, and not very robust, right? So they're built around this person-to-person payments use case, very narrow set of use cases. They are very unreliable. M-Pesa used to have, you know, I think probably three or four hours a week of downtime. They're better now, but you know that kind of latency or that kind of downtime would just be, you know, unheard of in a credit card system. I mean, I don't know if you'd use a credit card or a bank if you thought they were going to go offline a couple hours a week at you know, completely unexpected times. So you know, that kind of lack of robustness, as well as the inability to be open to allow third-party players to integrate through APIs and that kind of thing, So the mobile money systems are pretty basic and hard to hard to work with. And then the sort of more in you know credit card based systems or banking systems that can support some of these use cases have a lot of issues in terms of their cost structure primarily that make them hard to do. So we did like a, as I said kind of a design exercise, you know, talk to people all over the world and ended up building a prototype and are now going out to build a real reference model that we'll deploy in a couple countries. But we started with kind of first principles, right? So it needs to be digital for fairly obvious reasons, has to be robust, open, low cost, and secure, right? We wanted to be able to assure that those five principles were instantiated in any platform. We then kind of looked at what does the user need, right? What does the user experience need to be able to support? Easy account opening, you know, lots of paper processes and having to go to three different bank branches and all that kind of stuff, you know, really not going to work, right? You should be able to open your account yourself. And if you have to go into a physical location, it's only to meet some sort of regulatory requirement to show ID or give a fingerprint or whatever. You need easy access to cash in and cash out. Now, we think in the long run, we want to get rid of that, right, by giving people better options than to cash in and cash out. But no one's going to start off using a system if they think they can't get their money back. Obviously, it's got to be safe. You know, it's got to be trustworthy. You have to be able to move money to other individuals. And I think that's a difference in the developing world that's probably different from here. That's not as big a use case in the developed world, right? I rarely need to pay other people. But in the developing world where lots more transactions are informal and that kind of thing, you want to be able to move money to other people. Need to be able to do direct deposits. You know, people can get their wages and other things, direct deposit of wages, and these are government benefits. You need to be able to purchase things, and you need transparent and low fees, right? You can't have people thinking that they're kind of getting charged all the time. So that leads us to some of the design principles. So we think you want self-issued accounts and sort of tiered levels of KYC. KYC is know your customer, so how much due diligence you have to do should be tiered. Push payment model. Most credit cards are all on a pull payment model. And it's kind of subtle as to why push payment is initiated by the user's device. And it's not really, I think part of the reason why the legacy systems are built around the pull payment model is that it wasn't feasible to do real-time communication when credit card systems were first developed. And so what would happen is I give you my information, and you as the merchant then go pull that money out of my bank account, right, with my quote-unquote permission. And then the digital credit card systems were just built on that, on top of that model. And that adds a lot of transaction back-end stuff that's, in particular, I as a merchant now can pull from anybody, right? I mean, at least I could try, and that's where most of the fraud comes from in the system. And so there's a whole bunch of extra risk and fraud mitigation stuff that has to be in place. Whereas in a push payment model, I'm the only one who can activate my account. It's through my phone, and I have a PIN. And so if something goes out, it clears immediately and is immediately transferred. And that's another principle. And so these two, as well as the irrevocability, lead to a lot lower cost structure. A lot of the cost structure in credit cards is that you have the right to sort of revoke things, merchants can charge you for no reason, and so someone can fake being a merchant, that kind of thing. Of course, open loop. We want, you know, other third-party players to be able to integrate in and use the system. System-wide fraud and risk, so not that everyone has an individually siloed fraud and risk approach. And then, of course, high volume and low value payments are feasible within the cost structure of the system.
Does open loop include interoperability with other two different services or multiple services, or are you thinking more just open loop in terms of
currency, merchants?
So open loop, in general, should incorporate the ability for lots of different third-party players who want to be able to move money in ways that the system supports safely, should be able to do that, right? Through
but me sending money to a person that's on a different service.
So interoperability across platform as well, yeah.
Okay.
And we actually see this, the level one project, we're thinking about it really at the payment systems level, so, you know, at the national level, essentially. So what are the solution sets that enable some of these? You need an account opening service. consumer agent and account management service, these are just sort of different account management modules, essentially, interoperability for cross-platform interoperability, and then fraud and risk. And then the broader national strategy has to be more than just a technology platform, of course, right? So you need the technology, but also you need the regulatory framework. You need the right business models and scheme rules. You need certain governance so that the different scheme players feel ownership, operations, and the right level of communications and that kind of thing. So this was sort of the background. This is, I'll jump over this slide pretty quickly, just because we're getting on in time. But this is kind of the high level schema. And so I think the thing to look at here is this is sort of the legacy system, right? Commercial banks, card networks, the central bank, et cetera. And these systems are not very well geared for things that are explicitly mobile and very low cost and high volume. So lower income consumers in particular, but also small merchants and things like that. The other thing to note is in this new system, there's kind of a set of core services that are shared, and then there are the stuff that each digital service provider is going to build on their own, and where this is where the competition is in the market. And I'll show you some pain points. These are sort of the next generation issues. What we did to develop those was really to go through the different players inside this box, the DFS providers and the different end user stakeholders, and think through kind of what are their, given the system, you know, if it were set up, what would they still have as pain points in order to sort of execute?
The notion that you have a national digital financials, they're really the tie-in back to the central bank in terms of, you know, policy, currency controls, currency leaving the country like Nigeria, is that's really embodied up into that central pillar, right?
Yeah. So central banks, right. I mean, their kind of core mission is usually systemic stability and bank regulation, but they also often run various aspects of the payment system. They'll set up and manage the ACH and all that kind of stuff, and then they set up the rules for international transfers and all that kind of stuff. And some of them have all kinds of stuff like capital controls and things.
Yeah,
but
I've read about that.
Yeah. This, just to kind of give you a sense of all the different components that go into it, is the next level down in detail schema for the reference model. And you can see maybe in particular the stuff we see ourselves as commissioning to build directly versus stuff that's done through partners at different levels so some of it is, you know, direct support versus supporting through partners, and then some of it is just stuff that we think other people will eventually build on their own. But the kind of the core stuff of, you know, the interoperability integration and security and things like that are kind of the things where, and then also potentially some of the merchant processing stuff, at least the core elements of it, are things where we think we can add value because, you know, that's not something the market will necessarily do on its own, and where we think we can work with the government, for example, to set up kind of a core public good system. Not necessarily an NGO, right? Could be a for-profit company, but we see it as a public good in the sense that it's shared infrastructure for the broader economy.
You're actually funding third parties to build to your specifications some of those components?
Yeah, that's right. Yeah. So we will build a reference model. We're talking to some of the bigger systems integrators and other players. In the process of setting up, like I said, Pakistan and Nigeria, some of these components already exist in each country, so it's a little bit of like filling in the gaps on some level. But we plan to build a full reference model. And at the current plan is to then open source it and hope that, and try to support an open source community where others can build to the same reference model. And some of those other builds may not be open source. We're not sort of fixated on open source, but more that we want to, if we're going to pay for it, it should go into the public domain, basically. So that's the platform stuff. And that I think, to me, is an answer to the question, what is the right architecture and schema and business rules for the core of the system? In the time we have left, these are kind of what we see as sort of next generation issues and areas where we think more, you know, sort of direct point solutions from kind of emerging technologies are potentially relevant. These are areas that even if you have the architecture right and that, you know, L1P system in place, are still hard and can still, you know, benefit by people inventing new ways to do them, basically. And so I thought I'd just go through them, but I'd love to hear, you know, I think we can kind of discuss individual ones, and if you all have thoughts and things like that. Top one is fraud and cyber attack prevention, right? So, you know, this is sort of obvious, I think, in a financial system, we're constantly being attacked, and it's usually kind of proportional to the amount of money involved. Currently, there hasn't quite been, maybe hasn't quite been enough, and I think also partly because the systems are built for purpose and closed loop, so all run within the data center of one mobile operator, there hasn't been, that we know of, a whole lot of massive cyber attacks. But there's certainly fraud of different kinds. And there's certainly been insider fraud, so internal cyber attacks, if you want to call them that, people who are insiders within the company and have managed to kind of like, you know, jigger it to put 10 cents out of a transaction into their own bank account or whatever it is. Of course, you know, most of that stuff just never comes, you know, they don't allow that to be publicized in the newspaper if they can avoid it. So it's hard to know how much of this stuff there is, but it's, you know, it's certainly an issue in the long run, because the bigger the systems get, the greater the pressure on them will be. And there's a lot of fraud of the form, kind of petty fraud, person-to-person fraud, you know, calling up and pretending to be the, you know, whatever, the services operator and trying to get people's PINs and all this kind of stuff. Phishing stuff with text messages and all that kind of thing. And certainly more to come, I think, as this starts to get into the merchant business and that kind of thing. Proximity payments is another one. And I think that's one where why are we interested in proximity payments? I sometimes get that question, right? So, you know, it's not that we think poor people benefit by paying with a digital phone rather than with cash when they buy their groceries. I mean, that, you know, it's not really clear. But as I said before, what we think for the long run sustainability and health of the system, you need to achieve the ability to keep cash in digital form. And so that for that to happen, it's really critical to get the ability to buy things in the store, because that's most of someone's sort of, you know, day-to-day transactions are, you know, very, very small value proximate payments to someone who they're buying, you know, three tomatoes from in the market or something else, right? Or soap or whatever it is. So this is a real challenge, right? Because cash just works super good as a payment medium for proximity payments. I mean, I just, you know, I hand you cash, I can count it out easily, I'm familiar with it. It, you know, it's super fast, easy, you know, all that kind of stuff. And there's no fees.
But today, if you want to buy three tomatoes, couldn't you just do that by entering the merchant's phone number into your service?
Yeah, I mean, you can, but the guy selling three tomatoes on the side of the road typically isn't a merchant. But even if he was,
but he's a consumer, or she's a consumer.
Right, so you could pay them.
Chances are she has a phone herself.
Yeah, so there's a couple aspects of it, right? So one aspect of it is the fee, and that's not a technology issue, obviously. But another aspect of it is just the user experience, right? I got to punch in this guy's phone number, and you know, like not get it wrong, and then, you know, go through the menus and all that kind of stuff. And the current systems are really bad at that. So we're looking at stuff like NFC and barcodes and other ways to, you know, put all the information for the transaction quickly from one phone to the next. You know, some things that we think about and weigh as to whether we can make the assumption or not that, for instance, one of the parties has a smartphone if they're a merchant. You know, that those systems, those approaches become a lot easier, because obviously with a smartphone you can read a lot more things because they have sensors, and you can project a lot more data and things like that.
So you're thinking phone to phone.
Yeah.
And phone to terminal, phone to
right.
Point of sale terminal.
Yeah, you'd want to integrate it in, have the ability to integrate with legacy terminal based POS systems and things like that. But yeah, NFC, it could not be a phone, right, on some level, right? If you just had like an NFC chip or something like that.
Are the phones for these markets built with mobile payments in mind, or is it like they try and layer it on top of text messaging or something else?
Yeah. So I actually skipped over that slide, but the primary medium. So they're not built with mobile payments in mind for the most part. The communications protocol that most of them tend to use is USSD. Which is just a really basic session-based protocol that a low-end phone can initiate with just a code. So you'll have a USSD short code. It's like three numbers, and it's sometimes like star, three numbers, and hashtag, and that pops up like a menu. Some of them also use just sort of the direct integration with the SIM toolkit and the ability to put a menu item in the actual SIM card menu. That's better in the sense of from the user experience is a bit more integrated and smooth, but often requires a SIM swap. And so some operators have just opted not to bother trying to get all their clients to swap a SIM. And then some have tried to do it with kind of structured text message and things like that. But so the obvious issue with structured text message is not at all secure. And there's no way to really prove, you know, which phone it came from and all that kind of stuff. So,
So Jake, I'm going to have to take off, but thank you. I run payments for Microsoft.
Oh, okay.
So, I've spent some time with Roger and Costa before.
Oh, okay, yeah.
Some of this stuff, but it's always good.
If you got a card, leave it, and we'll get in touch. If you got a card, leave it, or send me an email.
Yeah,
and be in touch.
Send your card.
Okay.
Good.
Just to quickly go through the rest, identity. Identity is, you know, how do you identify people? We're looking at a lot of biometric stuff, and thanks a lot.
Thank you.
Yeah. There's a lot of challenges with if you could easily figure out who someone is, both for the transactional integrity, but also the onboarding and the KYC part, where you're actually signing them up. Most regulators want to know who people are so that they can mitigate against terrorism, financing, and money laundering, and all that kind of stuff. And that simple act of trying to figure out who someone is can actually add a fair amount of cost, at least relative to the amount of revenue generated by a really low-income person. And so we're looking at, like, you know, are there really quick ways to, could we capture a fingerprint through a mobile phone camera, basically, or things like that, so that we could really cheaply, in software, deploy identity solutions across some of the systems. Yeah.
On the phone number, right? There is no
that's right.
identity. That's yeah. what you can all anchor on.
Yeah. So, well, that's your. That's what you have, right? But it's not really who you are.
Yeah,
so anyone can have that phone number.
The linkage between them is sort of missing.
That's right. Yeah. So, and it's especially hard in the initial sign-up process, right? Because if I sign up, yeah. I mean, anyone can say I'm, you know, whoever, right? And so. Some, like India, has set up this really interesting system called Aadhaar, or the Universal Identity, and they have basically biometrically fingerprinted and iris scanned 900 million people at this point, and over the course of the past couple of years, and they have a really kind of simple core system that basically you send Aadhaar number or identity number and the biometric, and it'll give you an answer. Is this the person? You know, is that biometric match that number? And they can also send back name, address, one or two other fields. Really simple, right? But that just that capability in and of itself is really core to all kinds of identity questions. And so that kind of system, you know, especially to the extent that new phones are starting to come out with biometrics and things like that. The main issue is that, like, sometimes deploying biometrics broadly over a lot of, you know, lots of different retail points and things like that can be challenging. So being able to, I think, actually, if we could do it in software only on a mobile, that would be a pretty interesting.
Do you have any leads and how you complete those too?
Yeah, so I've seen there are some folks that like have a biometric, like a palm-based biometric that you can do through a mobile camera. And some extent it depends on what kind of verification you want to do. So if it's, you know, capture biometric and do a lookup, you know, the false positive rate is just too, you can't look up in 900 million people and find the right, you know, exact individual, right? Or you're going to get like 15 yeses. So, but if you want to do it for like a transactional, or if you're going to capture that and then just put in the person's name or something like that, that's fine. The main issue with Palm is that no one's, like there are no legacy databases of Palms, right? In most countries that I know of. So we'd love to have something that actually does fingerprints, since that's what a lot of these countries have actually over the last few years, often supported by the UN or somebody else around a voting, you know, an election or something like that. They've actually got big biometric databases that we try to boost off of. But if you have to have some specialized biometric, that's not going to work. Like there's ear prints and all, you know, there's all this kind of different stuff that you can do with a mobile, potentially with a mobile phone camera, but actually fingerprints are harder. So that could be a, I think that's an area that, you know, if someone came up with a solution, it'd be pretty important. Client activation is another one. It has to do with, again, signing people up, getting them onboarded, but also kind of communicating with them after the point of actual physical contact with messaging and things like that to keep them engaged and give them instruction and give them value and things like that. Analytics is also, you know, clearly an area where, you know, mobile phones are creating a huge amount of data. If they're also doing your payments and money transfer and things, that's also, you know, all, you know, whole other level of data where there's a lot of signal in terms of who you are and what you're doing and that kind of thing. And so risk scoring for credit, of course, is a big area currently in fintech in the developed world where people are using all kinds of alternative data sources to score. And you're seeing that trickle down. People are trying to use the mobile calling patterns and transactional patterns and things like that. There's also just in general, you know, the current, you know, mobile operators, they are sophisticated in very specific ways and then very unsophisticated in a lot of other ways, right? They're very good at their kind of core system integrity business and that kind of thing and keeping the mobile signal up and all that kind of stuff, but they're not very good at kind of other types of analytics and developing products and things that sort of leverage their data. Another one is Kiko agents. Like I said, this is an area where, you know, Kiko agents, cash in, cash out networks, they cost probably, like I said, 50 to 60% of the cost structure for these things is just keeping up those things up and running. And there's huge problems with cash stockouts or digital liquidity stockouts. Agents don't, you know, they don't stock enough. There's problems with how do you place agents in the right place? How do you manage them? And a lot of those things I think could be solved with data analytics. I mean, there's a guy at Harvard I talked to recently who's you know, just run a model. If you could get the agents to restock their cash according to his model, you know, when his model predicts they should restock and that sort of thing, they'd save, you know, 30, 40% of their cost structure, at least their cash in and out cost structure. Now, whether or not you could actually get them to behave that way is another question, right? So you have to figure out how to motivate them. But I mean, that, you know, that kind of thing, I think the prediction stuff using the data that's flowing out of the agent networks is currently not done at all. It's actually incredibly unsophisticated the way agents are managed. And there's almost no sort of automation of messaging and prediction and things like that. So I think that's potentially a really big area. And maybe there's also sort of hardware stuff at the point of sale, right? So agents, you know, they get past a lot of counterfeit currency in certain countries, and being able to detect some simple, cheap way to detect that would be really interesting. You know, I don't know, maybe there's security devices, really low cost, et cetera.
Did you say in many cases an agent is not typically operating on their own? They're part of some group of agents that's being funded by a third-party entity or individual?
Yeah, so you see different models. Often the mobile operator will contract with a series of super agents who then manage a string of 50 to 500 other agents. And those guys often do some sort of basic frontline support. So you do see, but you see different structures. Some of it's almost all in-house and there's no real subcontracting structure. Just kind of depends. Yeah. And then another big area is financial managing and budgeting tools for end users. So, you know, as with anybody, low-income people have a hard time keeping track. They have actually very complicated financial lives, which is surprising to some people. Everyone thinks it's very simple, right? You know, zero balance and that kind of thing. But like, they're actually very complicated. There's, you know, if you look at, you know, we've done very careful studies tracking their financial patterns over many, many years, for example, and you'll see that, for example, maybe 10 times the value of their income will flow through their house in and out. They borrow and lend and you know, receive gift from somebody and give a gift to somebody. And so, you know, maybe 10x what they actually spend and consume goes in and out of their household. And so they really have a very rich life of informal loans, gifts, you know, money transfers to friends in times of need, you know, all that kind of stuff. And I think in addition, and this is something that has come out in recent years in the research, the fact of being poor and kind of being pressed every day to make decisions and living a life where, you know, there's very little certainty. So they're sort of finding piecework from day to day, no steady job, no steady paycheck. That adds a huge amount of cognitive load on people. And it's just something that sort of behavioral scientists are getting better understanding of, but it diminishes their capacity to make sort of long-run planning and decision-making and things like that. And so we think there's a huge amount of potential for this kind of stuff if you could do it over the low-end interface that a mobile phone represents, right? So we're doing experiments with like text messaging and trying to come up with kind of the right messaging framing formats to motivate people to save, for example, or motivate them to pay back debt on a regular schedule or that kind of thing. And I think, you know, helping people with their budgeting, helping them kind of, you know, with the quote-unquote nudges, behavioral nudges and things like that, giving them maybe optimization tips. So, like, you often see people are borrowing at high interest and holding liquidity at zero interest, right? So, you know, just sort of pointing those kinds of things out. I think there's a lot to do here. It's complicated because a lot of it is more behavioral science than it is technology, but if you can build the two together, I think there's a lot that can be done.
So if you look at the underbanked, you know, population in developed countries, I mean, there's a huge, you know, when there's such an asymmetry of financial power, there tends to, the people who are underbanked tend to be overcharged, you know, and
right.
Things like check cashing services and payday loans and stuff like that end up tiptoeing toward predatory stuff. How do you keep all of that kind of stuff out of this? Is M-Pence and things like that, they're for profit, right?
Oh, yeah. Yeah. I mean, that's a huge question for us, especially like in the digital credit space, right? Like, you see, you know, some of these guys are offering either through a mobile app or through kind of a back-end service that's white-labeled through the mobile operator. You know, what's very attractive on some level, right? Because I can, on my phone, go on, register, sign up, and apply for credit and get an answer within, you know, 30 seconds, right? And I might get, you know, $50, $100, $200 loan. My loan term is typically 2 weeks. So if it's a short-term emergency, that's enough. But then my interest might be 3-4% over 2 weeks, which you sort of do the math over over the year is, it's about 100% or something like that, or a little more, I think. So, you know, I'm not doing my math very,
like
very good.
Payday loans here, it's worse than that, right? It's like, you know, $30 to borrow $150 for, you know, 10 days.
And you see that kind of stuff too, right? So,
But digital credit in these markets, that's a new phenomenon.
Right.
Right. It's just getting started. You said earlier, it's really, you have to have cash to get the value onto your phone, and you have to have the value on your phone to get cash out, right? There's
That's right.
You're not floating or crediting people generally.
No, I mean the system itself doesn't have inherent credit built into it, right? But people are trying to create credit products for people. And our worry is that like the potential of it seems great, right? But then how do you make sure that eventually that interest rate comes down to a level that's not, you know, frankly gouging people? And how do you make sure that they actually get value of it out of it and aren't just pressed into it by the urgency of their circumstances? So, and I think I think competition is probably an answer to that in some sense, right? So in the kind of fees that the mobile operators charge, we've seen them come down when more entrants successfully enter the market and start to grow the size of their client base. And so, you know, I think that's one of the big motivators for our level one project is to build a system where the mobile operator can't just set up a one party system and keep everybody out, but to actually build a more open architecture for the payment system as a whole, so that you get competition at different levels of the value chain that will actually drive the lower cost. But yeah, certainly, I mean, you can gouge people over digital just as much as you currently gouge people in sort of manual and face-to-face transactions. That's certainly true. So it's definitely something we think about a lot.
Also, coming to the last point, are there places where, are there things where you can actually get them to save? Maintain account
For sure, yeah. I mean, there are you know, successful saving products and things out there. One of the areas where we've seen success is what we call commitment accounts. So accounts that have some sort of friction associated with taking money out, and It can be as simple as like you commit to a group of other people who are savers that you're working, you know, that are part of your social network, and you all kind of chastise each other, right? If you take money out, can be that basic, but it can also be sort of more formal account features where you pay a fee to take money out if you take it out before you've reached your goal. So you might set a goal of, I don't know, $200 because you want to buy a sewing machine and start a business or something, right? So if you take it out before that, you get a penalty, or you want to save up for planting season. So if you take it out before planting season comes, you get a penalty, something like that. And we've seen, you know, we've run sort of randomized experiments with people who have those features and don't, and you actually see a fair amount of success in increased ability to save, and then even, you know, the knock-on effects of that, which are better planting, better investments in planting and farming and that sort of thing. So,
and then like on the back end, like there's a bank account for them, or like where is this money being put?
Depends. In that scenario I was just mentioning was a bank, but most of the commitment products have been through banks, mostly because the mobile operators' mobile money platforms are not flexible enough to instantiate that kind of account feature. They're very inflexible. They're just sort of really basic wallets. But I think they're moving in that direction. Most of them are upgrading platforms and things like that. So, but what we'd like to see is, you know, if that's a niche product that some people want, you know, you should be able to offer it without setting up the entire mobile money system, right? And the creative entrepreneur who comes up with just the right sort of marketing and system of, you know, Avon groups or whatever the right thing is that people actually then start to buy into it, should be able to access that system and deliver that product over the system through an API or whatever it is without having to, again, build the whole thing from scratch. So that's what we're hoping will happen. And it is starting to happen in certain cases where some of the operators have started to allow a little bit more access to their system. So I don't have, I'm out of slides. I'd love to hear any thoughts you guys have, and you know, if you just kind of have an idea down the road for technologies we should be looking at or ways in which we could collaborate. I mean, all we have, you know, partners on the ground who are kind of struggling with a lot of these things, and a lot of them are not very technologically sophisticated. And so, you know, the ability to kind of experiment, help them experiment with new approaches to this would be really valuable for us. And so I think, you know, for the reason to come out and talk to you guys is kind of, from my end, to kind of get you aware of the problems, and then I guess if you come up with things, thoughts for me, or just want to talk about it, get more involved, etc., you know, definitely reach out. I'd love to hear from you. So, yeah.
You talked about making some of this reference implementation open source. What's the time frame for that, and how would you kind of engage the community to build some momentum behind that?
Yeah, so that's something we're still really trying to figure out, because as you know, open source, you know, often sort of flops, right, and doesn't really create that sort of energetic community around it. So I don't know what our strategy is going to be honest. We're still, like I said, really wrestling with it. But the time frame, I think I think we have a prototype, which is not to say a reference implementation, but really just a prototype that like kind of like checks the box and will do basic things, but doesn't have kind of like the performance characteristics and ability to parameterize and things and all that kind of stuff that you would want from a full-fledged system. That may go into open sort of public domain sooner rather than later, next few months maybe. But again, I don't know how interesting that is, except to kind of play around with. I think the bigger project will probably not be until at least the end of the year, or maybe probably next year, my guess, but I'm not sure. It's not actually, that one's run by the other team, the one that's doing infrastructure, so I'm not probably as in touch with what their timeline is, but my sense is it'll be a ways down the road.
Not to oversimplify, but I will for a second. So it seems like analytics, although you call it out on number five, it seems like analytics would play a role in number one, number three, five, six, and probably seven.
Right.
And
yeah.
So I think about where, you know, Microsoft has been demonstrating some strength recently is in the cloud and machine learning and the analytics piece. And so I don't know how much of of the infrastructure that, or the reference designs that you're doing, have a cloud-based aspect to it that could tie into the machine learning that's coming along. But that would seem like an area that could unlock some value in a bunch of these different areas.
Yeah, that's a great point. It's true, these are not really kind of a messy list of things, right? The fraud and identity being, right? But and analytics definitely cuts across a lot of it. I think, the idea of having a cloud, especially maybe in the fraud area or any of the shared services where data is being shared in particular, probably a really good idea. One challenge is that in a lot of countries, in some countries there are explicit laws that state certain types of data can't leave the national boundary. And so cloud-based solutions are really tough in those countries for that reason. In other countries, it would just be politically difficult, from an optics perspective. But might still be feasible, might just take a little bit more sort of, getting everyone on board. But I do think, that makes a ton of sense. Actually, the whole thing could frankly be most of it could be in the cloud. Yeah.
Well, like in China, for instance, we had to set up joint ventures to basically operate within the national, licenses that come. So you'd have to probably do something similar in other markets.
Yeah, that's right.
Then the other thing is, I think I probably know the answer, but the fact that we're struggling on our Windows Phone market share, even with the Nokia acquisition. But we do have a lot of large screen devices. I just don't know how much of the unbanked, how much of the overlap is there between people who use mobile pay services and have larger screen, computers at home or something like that, and whether that would.
I mean, the vast majority of quote unquote our clientele are really at best on a low end phone.
Right. A flip phone or a candy bar.
Yeah. Exactly. Like yeah. If they're on anything else as an operating system, it's probably Android.
Yeah.
I mean, you guys probably know the market share on the phone side, in some of the developing countries.
Painfully, we know it painfully well.
I feel like sometimes when I travel, or I probably move the number by a significant fraction. It's even worse than here in the sense that like people haven't even bothered to deploy a lot of the computers that they would have because they're doing almost everything through smartphones. So, yeah.
So it's just related on the analytics. I mean, right now, all of that data is siloed per carrier, right? There's no kind of, if you want to do analytics for fraud or anything else, right? M-Pensa has its silo of data and everyone else is there. So there's really, we can speculate about what kind of patterns they're seeing and how things might improve, but there's no public access, right?
Yeah, there's certainly no kind of formal channel public access. We support different academic researchers, some of whom have managed to through just sort of handshaking and cajoling, get access sometimes to data sets that are maybe 6 months old or something like that. And they do see pretty interesting patterns. And we've done research on that data set, the call detail records and event detail records that come off of mobile phones, right? As you said, they're all mostly trapped in the mobile operator silo, but they're really fascinating data sets. I mean, we've done everything from plug them into epidemic transmission models to chart where's malaria going to go next and that kind of thing. So not even financial services related. But then also looking at, like I said, optimizing agent network, cash in, cash out patterns and things like that. We've even tried to use them to figure out who's rich or poor or who's male, female. I mean, you can just try to figure out all kinds of things about the population if you have some sort of labeled data set on the other side of who these people are.
Like whose data were you using for those tasks?
Each research project tends to be some other, sort of specialized.
One by one kind of negotiation for this particular purpose.
Yeah, it's very painful. It takes like a year per data set. So, yeah. But it is very interesting stuff. We've got a facility, a grantee that we've set up. One of their missions is to come up with a more systematic sort of standing order type approach, and potentially think through like what's the right, because it's very sensitive data, right? You can't just take out the phone numbers and you can still figure out who everyone is, right? Just by where they're moving and all this kind of stuff. So one of our grantees is sort of tasked with trying to figure out what's a kind of like a aggregation format that would leave enough resolution in the data to actually be interesting. If you wanted to chart, for example, maybe mobility patterns, for which there's a lot of uses for knowing that kind of thing, but low enough resolution that you couldn't identify individuals. And so there's, you know, obviously fairly technical ways to do that, but their goal is not, I mean, that part actually is not so hard to work out in any given context, but then setting up the political process around it and potentially like a shared data center resource or something like that, that would then make the data available appropriately to researchers or others, you know, on a kind of standing order basis.
To interrupt at this point, we have another meeting coming up at 3:00 with a group of folks who are calling in from Boston. So thank you, Jake, for
Thank you, guys. Like I said, send me an email or